Sam Fender returns with his brilliant new album, 17 Going Under. Includes the single 17 Going Under, Get You Down, and Spit of You. Sam Fender, 17 Going Under, out now.
Hi, this is Kelly.
And this is Jenna.
And you're listening to ODFM.
Today's episode is One Dookie for Murder. Are you ready? Okay.
I'm a little afraid. It might be a stinker of an episode. All right.
I researched a lot of uncomfortable information just so I could do an episode where the title was based on poop.
Because you loved the emoji. It's your favorite.
I just wanted so bad to do an episode with that title. Okay. Whew, here we go.
Oh, Lord.
So I first learned about this case a few months ago when I saw an article about the actor David Tennant starring in a three-part drama.
Were you sitting on the pot while reading a magazine?
It was like paper magazine? No, I had my phone like everybody else.
Right. That's not a thing anymore. Right.
You know, I am not going to say where I was reading it. I was dropping it like it's hot or
dropping a deuce.
Right.
Doo-doo.
Right. Dropping the kids off at the pool.
Oh, yes. Yep.
Okay. So I heard about this, that David Tennant was starring in this drama called Dez, which is about a Scottish serial killer. And I was like, ooh, that sounds interesting.
That sounds
And cool. I have not watched it yet because it's like a, it's not a true documentary. It's like a docudrama. And so I didn't want to.
Right. You didn't want to be influenced.
Yes. So as soon as we're done recording this, then I'm going to watch it because I'm like, ooh. This story is about Dennis Nilsen. And it sounds like Nielsen, but it's not. It's Nilsen. It's N-I-L-S-E-N. Nilsen.
Oh, okay.
Right. Because I kept saying Nielsen, and it's not Nielsen.
Nilsen. Okay.
He has been dubbed the kindly killer. I have no idea
How
why.
Is that possible? Yeah.
Honestly, now that I've done the whole episode, I'm like, they got that way wrong.
He's like, oh, can I murder you? Is that okay with you? Do I have your consent?
Like, oh gosh, who is it? Ed Kemper, who like touched the girl's boob while he was like assaulting her. And he's like, oh God, I'm sorry.
I feel so dirty. I hope you feel okay.
I was just trying to kill you. I didn't want to touch your boob. My bad.
I didn't want to assault you.
So bizarre, right?
Ooh, creepers.
He's also been called the Munswell Hill murderer because he lived in Munswell Hill at the time. And the British Jeffrey Dahmer.
Ew. Mm.
That was a good one. You're like, ew.
Ew.
He murdered at least 12 young men and boys from 1978 till 1983 in London.
Oh, no.
While serving a life term in prison, he recorded hours and hours and hours of audio tapes.
Oh,
he liked to
no.
hear himself talk. Because he was hoping to publish his autobiography.
Oh. I wonder if they have the same laws over there where they can't get paid for their story of killing.
Gosh, I don't know. So I do know that the government blocked him from publishing it in the 90s. But in January of 2021,
oh no,
a book entitled History of a Drowning Boy was released.
Ew.
And then in August 2021, this year, there's that drama called Dez, because that was his nickname, I guess, was Dez. And on Netflix, there is this lovely little documentary that I watched called Memories of a Murderer, the Nilsen Tapes. Holy freaking psycho, narcissistic, oh my God. I had a hard time listening to it. And it wasn't even what he was saying. I just got to the point where I couldn't stand the sound of his voice anymore.
One of those. Oh, you're so freaking annoying.
Big trigger warning, guys. This episode is definitely not for the faint of heart. There is necrophilia.
Mm.
There is dismemberment.
Mm.
There's lots of gory details.
Mm.
So if that's not your thing and you like our lighter hearted murder stories, you might want to skip this episode. If you can handle gory details, this one's for you.
Nice.
But don't eat. don't.
Do not eat ahead of
time. Do not. Whatever you're doing, put it down right now.
Ooh.
I've warned you.
Okay.
So our story takes place on a,
so innocently.
On a blustery February day. No, okay. So February 9th, 1983. The Hornsey Police Station in North Swanson.
Oops.
Yeah. We're going to try to use Dookie and we're going to try to use Hornsey and we're going to try not to laugh. It's going to be bad. But also, I'm probably going to just destroy a couple of these British towns and stuff because I'm going to try.
Yeah.
I'll do my best.
I'm Detective Richard with the Hornsey Station.
The Hornsey Police Station. Okay. So,
This is
Detective Inspector.
Oh, right.
Steve McCusker. Hmm. Okay. So, Detective Inspector Steve McCusker and his superior officer, Detective Chief Inspector. They have some long-ass titles. Detective Chief Inspector Peter J. are called out to 23 Cranley Gardens in the North London suburb of Munswell Hill. Plumbers called them. Because they had made a gruesome discovery.
I think they often make gruesome discoveries.
I don't think they ever find anything. They don't ever find anything pleasantly surprising. No. They're never
look at the roses in the toilet. No.
Doesn't happen.
Doesn't. No.
No.
Not
no,
too often.
No,
I
no.
don't think. Yeah.
The day before, Mike Catran, an employee of Dino Rod.
Ooh.
That's the plumber. Dino Rod.
Dino.
had been, it reminds me, it sounds like, wasn't like the name of like one of the things in like Cars, Disney's Cars? Like, wasn't there like Dino? Remember?
There was.
It was like the fuel, wasn't it? Dino Rod. It was like, I kept looking
there
at
was,
that.
There was, but weird. I can't think of what it was.
Right? Because it was like the dinosaur for like the oil.
Yeah. I was Total thinking tangent. Like a fishing rod. Dino Rod.
Dino Rod. Catch two fish at once.
But it's probably it's probably really like one of those snakes, the pike snake.
Gross. I don't
okay.
even want to.
I'm already feeling gross.
Yeah,
gotten to details.
You will never clean out a pee trap of your own sink again. Let me tell
God,
you.
No.
So this Mike Catran, the plumber, had been called out by residents to fix a blocked sewer drain. When he removed the manhole cover that was on the side of the building outside, he saw what looked to be a mass of flesh and small broken bones.
No.
Several of the residents of the building had come to see what was causing the blockage, because apparently had been a big issue. People were dropping it left and right, and it was backing up on them, and they were like, what the hell?
I'm tired of seeing my own shit.
Exactly. Resurface. They wanted to know who took a giant elephant dump and clogged the entire system, right? So they were like coming out to be like, one of you all there.
Who is it?
Needs some more fiber.
One of you needs to get your bowels checked because something's wrong.
Exactly.
Oh.
So this blockage had been an ongoing issue for months, right?
Oh.
Right. Mm-hmm. So there was one resident in particular who was very interested in what was in the sewer drain. And it was the man who lived in the top floor flat. He said, excellent line. Looks to me like someone's been flushing down their Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Ew.
You know what?
Also,
like, struck me. What? Go ahead.
Well, I was just thinking, how does it go down the drain?
I don't know. But my thought was, I didn't know that Kentucky Fried Chicken was in England. You know, I just was like, oh, they have that?
You were like, you guys have that too.
That was my thought. I was like, you know, I mean.
You don't have like, Mansfield Fried Chicken.
You know, I was kind of surprised. I'm like, I didn't know they had Kentucky Fried Chicken in Europe. Because I just
Edinburgh Fried Chicken.
Right? I mean, Americans eat like crap, so I didn't know they So I was just, I found that surprising. So
Edinburgh gently boiled chicken.
Okay, so it was actually near the end of the day when the plumber had come out. And it was snowing, it was February, it was cold, it was getting dark. So his boss told Mike Catran, put the manhole cover back on. We're going to come back in the morning when there's better light.
All the residents
no one take a shit for the next 12 hours.
You just hold it.
Right.
Or just go down the street to the local pub.
Exactly.
Whatever you got to do.
So they're like, well, we're going to come back and we're going to check it out in the daylight. Because this, I don't know what that is, but we're going to deal with that tomorrow. That's
very
a tomorrow.
Fleshy.
It's It's after five and we're going to...
You know what? Yeah, we got to go get our pint.
This is a tomorrow type thing, right? But the next morning, when they opened up the manhole cover, they found that the drain had been cleared out. And when I say cleared out, Mike Catran told an interviewer, a TV interviewer, if a drain can be sparkling, it was sparkling.
Whoa.
Right? So someone like...
Oh, my God.
Like, literally cleaned the shit out of it. Yeah.
Gave the killer a chance to clean up after himself. Exactly. Like, oh, red flag. I better go get take care of that.
Right, exactly. Oh, shit. Look what's there.
Left my Kentucky Fried Chicken again.
Right, exactly. But the plumber was able to reach into a few of the pipe openings. Because that's what you want to do, is close your eyes and reach in there. And pulled out what looked like skin and knuckles of a human hand.
Oh, my God.
I told you not to eat.
I didn't. Now I won't.
Yeah, right? All right. I'm good till tomorrow.
I'm good. Good diet.
That's when they called the police. They're like, okay, this is it's going to be a problem. So the suspected tissue and bones were taken to a mortuary. And a pathologist confirmed that they were, in fact, human remains, not Kentucky Fried Chicken.
Can I not have any knuckles in my order today, please?
Chicken knuckles. I would like the wings and the knuckles, please. Is that white meat or dark? I don't want to
know. Oh, let's not find out.
Okay, let's not go there. Okay. In fact, there was a piece of flesh that they were able to identify as being from a human neck. I don't know how you can tell the difference.
How do you know? Oh,
I don't know.
God.
But not only could they tell that it was from a neck, but there were clear ligature marks on the skin.
Oh, so my God.
I don't know how big this piece was or how you could tell.
Maybe it had part of the throat in it.
Oh. I don't.
Oh, my tummy hurts.
So residents told police that they had heard the man who lived on the top floor flat, Dennis Nilsen, going up and down around midnight. He was very busy overnight. Dennis, who sometimes went by the name Dez, I don't really understand how Dez is short for Dennis, but
I was
whatever.
Thinking Desmond, but okay.
He was a civil servant who worked at a job center as a supervisor. So like a recruitment center, like a job, you know.
Okay, getting jobs for people.
So, right. Police
I have a job for you. You need to clean some sewer.
Shit. Better cover would have been, I work for Kentucky Fried Chicken, and sometimes I bring my work home with me. And, but no,
didn't flush the knuckles.
So, okay. Police knew that he was due to arrive home from work around 5:30. So they were like, well, we're going to wait because we would like to talk to him.
And go see what he's up to.
When Nilsen arrived and the officers identified themselves, he responded with, since when do police officers get interested in looking at people's drains?
Since there's... flesh and bones found. Yes.
Since chickens don't have knuckles. That's
Grody.
They asked to speak to him in his flat and they followed him upstairs where they were greeted with a god awful smell.
I knew you were going to say smell.
Just,
I mean, I just
you knew
had
where I was
feeling.
Going with this, right?
Had a feeling.
His flat was dirty and messy. I saw pictures of it. Very sparsely furnished with mismatched furniture. There was a bare mattress with stains on it. It looked very much like a bunch of college guys all just lived there. You know, it was just gross and dirty and very just like there was just a chair in the corner and nothing matched. And
probably not a place you'd take your date.
Right. It did not look like the place where a 37-year-old professional gentleman lived.
It looked like a teenage boy.
Borderline crack house. Like it just
like one step above because it actually had the mattress.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Ooh.
So anyway, Detective Chief Inspector Peter J was direct. They walked in, the place was gross, it reeked like decomposition.
It's like, dude, you nasty.
Right. So he just goes, stop messing us about. Where's the body?
Stop messing us about.
Didn't start with the pleasantries the light. Tell us, you know, he was just like, there's a body in here.
Yeah.
Just.
I smell it.
So Dennis looked shocked at first.
You can smell that.
He was
maybe he doesn't have a sense of smell.
Smell. Yeah.
Yeah. I have a friend COVID. That doesn't have any. Yeah. Oh, he had COVID right beforehand. Yes.
See, it really was around, like, all the way back in 1983. So he looked shocked, but only for, like, a second. And then he goes, it's in there, and pointed to a wardrobe.
Oh, no.
Inside, there were two large black garbage bags packed with human remains.
Oh, my God. Was he trying to flush them one little piece at a time or something? Oh, your face. No. Stop.
This is when it would have been better to have a garbage disposal.
Yeah,
or just don't.
Maybe some other way. There's got to be some.
Or maybe just don't kill people.
There we go.
That's also an option.
That's also probably the best option.
So they saw that, and Dennis Nilsen was immediately arrested upon suspicion of murder. I mean, because you don't know, you know, you someone could have left those here, right?
Yeah.
You know.
Previous tenants. Yeah.
I don't know how they got here, you know. In the police car. The police asked Dennis, how many bodies are there, one or two? He answered, I've killed 15 or 16.
So he's been flushing for a while.
Yeah. He said, there are three back here, and the rest were killed at my flat that I used to live in.
Oh, they had a better septic system there. Or some sort of better sewage.
There was a better system.
Oh, God.
Crime scene officer Jerry Jackson received the biggest shock he'd ever had at a crime scene. You know he's seen some shit, right? This guy has... he's a crime scene.
Ba-dum-bum. Yeah.
Shit. Yes. You know, he's seen some, like... This was bad. The kitchen, in a large pot, he found a human head.
No.
It had been boiled, but some of the skin was still hanging off and some of the hair was still left on the scalp.
Oh, God. I have chills.
Okay. It's not what you... In the bathroom, there was a large drawer that had been set upside down and used as a shelf. So, like, imagine, like, a large dresser drawer and he had just turned it over. That's what I mean. Like, he lived like a college student.
Yeah, like, just like using whatever he could find.
This can be a table. Like, you know, like, whatever. Here's a box. Like, yeah. You know. Very half-assed. So there was this large drawer set upside down, and there was shit all over it.
Yeah.
Bathroom things, right? Underneath it was a pair of legs sticking out of the end of a black garbage bag.
Dude.
So, you know, if you do use a drawer as a table, there's storage underneath.
Yeah.
So.
Didn't have any other place for those.
Right.
Had to put them under.
There was also a wooden box that contained limbs and a torso.
Oh, my God.
And then four smaller shopping bags, like the kind you get like at Target or Walmart.
Uh-huh.
And those were filled with internal organs.
No.
Yeah, they were.
What's he doing? Is he eating these things?
Ooh, we'll get there.
Oh, shit. I don't like
him. Back at the police station, Dennis was freely talking to investigators, answering all their questions. He just was a chatty cat.
Wow.
He was just like, blah, blah, blah. He was calm and relaxed. And the only thing he was concerned about was his dog that was still at the flat. He had a dog.
He cared about his dog. Oh, my God. What was he feeding the dog? Oh, no.
He gave detectives details of the men he had murdered over the past 4 years.
Oh, my God.
But he could only remember the names of two or three of the men that he had killed at his most recent apartment.
Yeah. Well, you know, it's hard to keep track. Yeah, details, hard to keep track after so many.
Deep breaths, everybody. Are we good? Are we ready?
Oh, God. Okay. All right. Pepto-Bismol on board.
I'm going to take you back now.
Oh, God.
Dennis Andrew Nilsen was born on November 23rd, 1945, in the town of Fraserburgh, Scotland. He was Scottish. His father, Olav Magnus Nilsen.
Wow.
Olav Magnus, right? Magnus. He was a Norwegian soldier. His mother, Betty White, different Betty White.
Yeah, I love Betty White.
She spells it W-H-Y-T-E. So, big difference. So don't mix those two up.
No, because the American Betty White is like a goddess.
The bomb.
So,
right. Yeah, exactly. But his mother was a strict Catholic. They had three children together, Olav Jr., Dennis, and a daughter named Sylvia.
Oh, poor Olav Jr.
Yeah.
No, I didn't want to be the junior.
Right.
Damn it.
His father wasn't very committed to their marriage. He was a soldier. This was, he didn't take it seriously. He wasn't a good provider.
Okay.
They lived actually with Betty's parents.
Oh, no.
Yeah, they didn't even have their own house.
Oh.
And their tumultuous marriage ended when Dennis was only four. So it didn't last long at all.
Wow.
So Dennis, however, had a very close relationship with his grandfather, and he referred to him as his hero and his protector. Uh-huh. His grandfather, however, was in poor health and died of a heart attack at the age of 61.
Yeah. Oh.
But no one explained this to six-year-old Dennis. So he's only 6 years old. His dad's already left. Now his beloved grandfather has died.
Oh, no.
But no one explained that to him.
Oh.
He was just brought in. No, they just brought him in to see him in the coffin that apparently was in the dining room.
Oh.
And all he was told was his grandfather was sleeping and had gone to a better place.
Oh, no. Yeah.
So there are some experts that believe that this was the first place where in his brain there was like a little confusion began between the idea of love and death. Like, together.
Oh.
So I don't know, but don't do that to your kid.
No.
I'm not saying they're going to turn into a serial killer, but.
No, but
you're
maybe
not doing
a little bit more
favors.
Honesty
right.
would be good. Holy shit.
So after his grandfather's death and upon realizing that he was sleeping and not coming back. Dennis became very withdrawn. Unlike typical serial killers, he was actually repulsed by cruelty to animals.
That is very odd.
Right? Usually that they start small. But no, he actually was very protective of animals and stuff like that.
He just hated humans.
It was just a human thing. But, you know, I mean, can kind of relate.
I know. I wasn't going to say it, but I was like, yeah, I get it. I got it. Some humans really suck.
I know.
Not
right?
enough to want to kill them.
So his mother did remarry and had several more children and had no time for Dennis.
Oh, no.
As he entered puberty, he realized that he was attracted to boys.
Mm-hmm. Which probably was really bad at the time.
Not approved of, right? Not accepted. Mm-hmm. He was subjected, so he had this strict Catholic mother, and his stepfather was a strict disciplinarian, he gave plenty of lectures on impurities of the flesh and the evils of homosexuality.
Mm, wonderful.
He definitely, buried that, he hid that.
Yeah, gonna cause a little psychosis there.
Right? So he's got all kinds of things going for him as as his brain is developing. Oof, there.
This poor kid.
So at 15, Dennis was desperate to get away from his family.
I bet.
So in June of 1961, he enlisted in the British Army Catering Corps. Well, I didn't even know that was a thing, but whatever. He became an apprentice chef.
Uh-oh.
Army chef.
And cooking.
Got training as a butcher.
Oh, God, of course.
Right.
Of course he did.
Which will serve him well later on.
Yeah.
Okay. So his first 3 years in the catering corps when he was training were the happiest years of his life. He was away from his family. He was with other cadets or whatever they called them or whatever. So he didn't feel like
found
an outsider.
Something he knew and liked and
right. He had people to
Make
get along
friends.
With. He had friends.
Yeah.
Right. While in the army, he had several casual encounters, sexual encounters with men.
Yeah.
But he also explored sexual fantasies he had involving dead bodies.
Oh, no, wait, no. Because he
that
can
whole
encounter.
Love and death thing kind of got.
Yeah, and when you're in the army, you do encounter some dead bodies.
He would cover himself in talc to make his body very white, and he would make his lips blue, and then he would masturbate in the mirror.
Wow.
Mm.
Wow. That's. Yeah. Disturbing beyond.
Yeah, that's not even the most disturbing thing in the story.
Oh, God. Dennis.
Honestly, I stopped and I was like, what did he use to make his lips blue? Lollipop?
Oh.
Anyway, this is where my mind goes.
Blueberries.
Like, blueberries. Ooh, maybe blueberries. Okay, that's good. All right. Anyway. Okay, tangent.
Not going to try it myself. We'll just conjecture.
Right, exactly. By October 1972, Dennis had left the army after 11 years. He served for 11 years. He moved to London and he began training to become a Metropolitan Police Officer.
Oh, shit.
Exactly.
How many times does this seem to happen? I know. Well, now I'm all skillful.
Right. Let's see. I've learned my butchering skills. Now I'm going to learn about police. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
He had hoped, so he joined the police hoping to find a similar camaraderie that he had in the army. He wanted the same, hey, I'm part of a group.
Right.
But there was a great deal of homophobia in the police department at the time. And also, homosexual acts were illegal.
Oh,
so it was really weird and odd for him to be a police officer at the time, right?
Kind of a bad combo.
What he did get out of being part of the police force was a fascination with the morgue and autopsied bodies.
Oh, fun.
He had access to that. So it wasn't all
maybe he
it wasn't
have
all
been
bad.
A medical exam? Or of course, he would have had to go to school for or worked at a morgue. Yeah.
Or worked at a morgue. Ooh, right.
But I can imagine what would happen then.
Oh, God. Yeah.
There's just no good way.
He was very lonely. He drank heavily.
Mm-hmm.
And he began to frequent the London gay bar scene. After just a year, he quit the police force, claiming it was due to homophobia in the police. Could have been for many reasons.
Mm-hmm.
And he began working as a civil servant, as a recruitment interviewer at a job site.
Okay, so, getting people jobs.
So this is where he gets his job, and this is where he's going to stay for the next several years, right? He just he gets promoted and everything. He's actually very good at his job.
Doing well. Okay, getting people jobs.
He can be helpful. Around this time, Dennis met a young man named David Painter through work. And one evening, Dennis invited him back to his flat with him.
Oh, God. We already heard how he keeps house.
Oh, God.
The guy's like horrified. Jesus,
yeah,
gross.
Yeah, right. At some point, David fell asleep and awoke to find Dennis taking pictures of him.
Oh, shit.
Yeah. No,
that's
I don't like that
not
at all.
Okay. No.
He was so upset with Dennis that he somehow managed to injure himself. I could not get any more information, but like he got really upset and in the well, actually, I can see how this happens because I've gotten so upset where I actually like
trip
injure myself because I'm, you know, clumsy. Right. So I'm just like, you know, and then it just makes it worse. Right.
Totally. So, and then you're more mad.
So he's mad. It's kind of like how your pants only get caught on the handle of a door
always.
When you're in a bad mood.
Yes.
It never happens any other
time.
Right. So anyway, so he was like furious that he wakes up and Dennis is taking these pictures of him.
Yeah.
He gets all mad and he must have bumped his head or I don't know something. All I know is that he had to go to the hospital. Like
Shit.
He injured himself. Like, I don't know if he got all mad and he broke
a
glass. Or
everything is a mess there. So he probably tripped over shit,
you're
like backing up
exactly.
And he's like, and he fell.
Totally,
and hit his head.
Right. Anything could have happened, right? He did go to the police and Dennis was questioned, but nothing came of it.
Shit.
Right. Which sucks because, man, a whole bunch of crap could have been avoided right there.
What would they have gotten him on, though?
Messy house.
Yes, messy house and taking unwanted photos.
That's true. Or maybe they could have at least, like, flagged him or something.
Yeah, so maybe keep an eye on this guy.
Right. But that didn't happen.
Uh-oh.
So by 1974, Dennis had only had casual sexual relationships. Just one-night stands or
lasting
a week or two. Nothing, you know. And what he really wanted was a long-term relationship. I mean, he was a
wanted
romantic.
Commitment.
Wanted a commitment. He wanted the
he
ring.
Wanted commitment.
Right?
Oh, dude, you got to clean your flat first. Just
I
saying.
Know, right?
Step one.
Exactly.
Maybe invest some money into some better furniture and take a shower.
One night when Dennis was 30 years old, he met 20-year-old David Galichan.
God, he likes these Davids.
He's into Davids.
Yeah, and to D names.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, we like Ds.
So he meets, oh boy. Wow.
Okay.
Well, we must, because look at the name of our podcast. But
that's right.
They ended up going home together, and David never left, which is shocking, because the way he kept house, my God.
Mm-mm.
But he never left. Now, Dennis claimed they were a couple. David insisted they were roommates.
Oh, I was thinking you meant, like, never left, as in he died.
Oh, no. No, they moved in together.
Killed him. Okay.
No. David moved in, and so, like, I think, like, a couple weeks later, they decided to move into, like, a bigger place together,
nice.
Right?
Okay.
So, and there is some back and forth as to whether or not they were a couple or not, but also, these are people being interviewed after, you know, at the time.
Right, being
it wasn't
gay
good
was
to be gay,
not,
right?
Not acceptable at that time,
not
so
acceptable.
Yeah, you're going to try to...
And then now, even though it's acceptable... Being with a serial killer is not.
Is.
So either way,
yeah.
You probably
either way
be
you're
like,
kind of like oh,
totally roommates. We were
totally
just
roommates.
Friends.
Oh, she is.
So maybe roommates with benefits. It's hard to say. In November of 1975, Dennis and David, the D's,
The D-Boys.
Right, exactly. Moved into a ground floor flat with exclusive use of the back garden. So Dennis had actually spoken to the landlord, and the back garden really wasn't being used. Mm. It was just kind of like
a weed garden.
Exactly. Nobody was doing anything with it. There was, you know, stuff was just being kind of tossed back there or whatever. He asked if they could have exclusive use of the garden. Mm. That would be theirs, right? This was at 195 Melrose Avenue in North London. They even got a puppy together that they named Bleep.
That's actually pretty cute.
I know, right? Bleep the puppy.
Bleep. Hey, get over here, Bleep.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. They got this puppy together. They spent hours together working to fix up the back garden. You know, they planted stuff and they fixed it up. Right. It was nice. It ended up being, you know, a nice outdoor space. But by May of 1977, the relationship, whatever it was, had soured.
Oh, no.
David said he left. Dennis said he kicked him out.
Right. One of those situations.
He said, I don't know. But when David moved out, Dennis threw himself into work and the gay bar scene and alcohol. He was depressed. He was like, obviously, I can't be with anybody. I'm not relationship material.
I'm a psychopath.
Right. Yes, exactly.
All these things that contribute.
By the end of 1978, so they ended in May of 77. So it's been like a year and a half. And he's in a pretty deep depression now. He's really...
Yeah.
And he was afraid he was going to be alone forever. So on December 30th, so it's the night before New Year's Eve. So, you know, like, it's after Christmas. It's just before New Year's Eve. I mean, when you're depressed, it's where everybody else has somebody but me, you know.
Oh, God.
So December 30th, he's desperate for company. So he goes out to one of the pubs that he frequented, the Cricklewood Arms.
What's with all these weird pub names?
I don't know. The Cricklewood. He met a young man and he brought him back to his flat. They drank until they both passed out.
Oh, that's fun.
And when... And when Dennis woke up, he was overcome with this need to keep this young man as his companion forever, no matter what.
So he got a cage.
That could have potentially worked too. No, he didn't get cage. He didn't even ask, honestly. Mm. He could have said, sure, but
he should have asked first. Maybe he would have complied, but probably not.
While he was still sleeping, Dennis took a necktie and strangled him until he was completely incapacitated. Not dead, but, he was.
Yeah.
And then drowned him in a bucket.
Jesus Christ.
Yes.
Wow.
He then took the corpse, bathed it, and dried it, and then put it back into his bed, attempted to have sex with it.
Oh, God.
That's all it said. I didn't want details. No. I don't want to know what happened, what didn't happen.
Dude.
And then he slept next to it.
Oh.
So it took until January of 2006, but that first victim was finally identified, but they didn't identify him until... That happened in 78. He wasn't identified until 2006. He was identified as Stephen Dean Holmes. Mm. He was actually only 14 years old.
Oh, he's a baby.
He had been way home from a pop concert and had stopped at a bar and was churned by alcohol.
Oh,
and
baby.
Yeah. He ran into Dennis Nilsen. Eventually... Dennis placed Stephen's corpse under the floorboards and kept it there for 7.5 months.
Oh, my God. The stink.
Right?
What the what, dude?
7.5.
How do the neighbors not?
In August of 1979, 7.5 months later, Dennis removed Stephen Holmes's corpse from the floorboards. Dismembered him, took him out into the back garden, and burned him in a bonfire behind his flat. And remember I said it was kind of like it was just kind of a trash.
Yeah.
You know, people just threw shit back there.
Yeah.
He added parts of an old tire to the fire to disguise the smell of the burning flesh.
Okay, so it's very toxic anyway.
Right.
Plus, yeah. Oof.
I still, as a neighbor, would have complained, being like, dude, why are you burning a tire? What the
Black
hell?
Fucking smoke everywhere,
oh,
man.
Oh, God, right? A couple months later, in October of 79, Dennis attempted to strangle a student from Hong Kong named Andrew Ho that he had met at a West End pub. Okay. Andrew, however, managed to get away and reported Dennis to the police. Dennis was interviewed. But he told them, well, you know, we were experimenting with bondage and things got a little too far.
No.
And Andrew, because again, the whole homophobia
the
of the time. Right.
Yeah.
He decided not to press charges and everybody just went on their merry way.
Which I understand completely.
Right.
Just don't want to be out there.
Oh, God. Yeah. So in December, so now another 2 months later.
Oh, Jesus.
Dennis met a 23-year-old Canadian tourist named Kenneth Akindon.
He likes these travelers.
Because, you know, nobody knows to look for him. Right?
Shit.
So he met Kenneth in a gay bar. They spent the day sightseeing and drinking, and then they went back to Dennis's flat. And Kenneth was sitting there listening to music on Dennis's headphones.
Oh, God.
And Dennis took the cord from the headphones and wrapped it around his neck and strangled him with it.
Oh, no.
He went as far as to drag Kenneth across the floor by the cord.
By the cord?
While it was wrapped around his neck, he pulled him across the... Okay.
Jesus Christ.
Then supposedly, Dennis poured himself a glass of rum and drank it while he listened to the same set of headphones. He took the headphones off of him, put it on, had a little rum, chilled out.
I'm grossed out.
Then, I guess after he had done that, he washed Kenneth's lifeless body, had sex with it, and slept next to it.
Good God. Why does he wash him? That's what I wonder.
Maybe because his grandfather was pristine in a box. I don't know. You know, he wants them to be clean and
take care of them.
I don't know, man. The next day, he went out and purchased a Polaroid camera and took of the corpse in various suggestive poses.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. I mean, this guy's seriously fucked up. Then he stored his body under the floorboards.
It's like, right? I have the same spot that I've used before. This worked before.
Exactly.
Let's do it again.
Over the next several weeks, Dennis would take the body out periodically and wash it and dress it, have conversations. They'd sit and watch TV.
But at some point, wouldn't the stuff be coming off? It's like, flesh things. I don't know.
I know, right?
Reminds me of like Weekend at Bernie's, but in a really bad way.
But not
like not in a really not a funny way.
Yeah, you know, now that you bring that up, that movie is much less funny. Weekend at Dennis's.
Weekend at Dennis's.
Shit.
7 months with Dennis.
Woo.
Oh.
Yeah, the sequel is not nearly as good.
Mm-mm.
In May of 1980, 16-year-old Martin Duffy hitchhiked to London without telling his parents.
Oh,
he
Martin.
Was a catering student, and he was hoping to find work.
Mm.
After sleeping in the train station for 4 nights,
he
met Dennis Nilsen, who offered him a meal and a place to sleep. So he was like, yeah, man, I could use that, right?
Sure. Oh, God.
Once Martin had fallen asleep, Dennis strangled him with a necktie and drowned him in the kitchen sink.
Oh, my God.
He was kept in a wardrobe for 2 weeks before being placed under the floorboards.
So I'm guessing he did the same thing with this guy.
Yeah. Mm. He kept Martin had a briefcase and he kept it to use as his own. Mm-hmm. In fact, I believe I saw somewhere, I'm not certain, but I know I saw somewhere that, I know they said that they kept it for his own and that he used it. But I also remember in one of the things I saw when they were waiting for Dennis to come home, when they, you know, wanted to talk to him because they found the flesh, that he showed up wearing a trench coat, holding a briefcase. And I believe it was Mark, you know, they didn't know at the time that it was a victim's briefcase, but he just, oh, it's mine now.
Yeah. I mean, this guy died, so.
Oh, God. He also kept a set of professional chef's knives that Martin had actually received as a gift from his father. Kept them and later used them to dissect his victims.
Oh, my God.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
He couldn't go get his own knives.
No, couldn't go buy his own knives. Lazy bastard. After that, Dennis began killing more frequently. I mean, he had it down to a science now. He knew what he was doing. He had a plan. He had a whole ritual. He knew what he was doing.
Was good at it now.
Nilsen could only give police vague descriptions of his next five victims. Like, he was 5'9" and had blue eyes. Like, he couldn't give a name or anything.
It's just getting frenzied.
But he did remember in graphic detail how each one was murdered and exactly how long he kept it before dissecting it.
Oh my God.
So you could tell what was important to him.
Yeah.
They obviously weren't anything to him because he couldn't even remember their names.
Yeah. These are just objects.
Right.
For me to use. Whew. Okay.
You haven't fun yet or what?
Oh my God. I'm so disturbed. No wonder you had bad dreams the other night.
I have been writing this episode for like 3 straight days and I cannot sleep. So now he's got this collection of bodies under the floorboards, right? He's like, oh my God.
He hasn't been burning them with tires.
That was just the first guy. He had a whole bunch in there now. So
maybe he got some complaints with the tire fire. So he's got to find something else.
As you said, you know, when they start decomposing and stuff. Mm-hmm. So they were starting to attract insects.
Yeah, I would have thought they
had
been.
And the smell. I didn't write about it, but as you can imagine, he was like, oh, crap, maggots. And there was a whole section on it. And I just was like, you know what? We'll just use our imaginations.
Yeah, we know.
Mm-mm. This was like summer 1980 now. So it's.
Yeah, it's getting hot in here.
So. He tried to deal with the smell and insect situation by placing deodorants beneath the floorboards and spraying insecticides in his apartment twice daily. Oh, it's a shame he didn't die from the toxicity breathing that shit in. Neighbors would be complaining about the smell coming from his flat, and he told them it must be from structural problems with the building.
Yes, yeah. I've been taking dumps in the floor. I can't explain it.
Right. I don't know what's going on.
I don't know. Weird.
It was obvious that he had to get the corpses out from under his floorboards. I've collected a few too many.
Oh, God.
He removed all of his clothing because, you know, we don't want to get anything on it. So he stripped down, pulled the bodies out from the floor, dismembered them on his stone kitchen floor with a large kitchen knife. He boiled the skulls to remove their flesh.
Oh my God, dude.
And placed the organs in plastic bags for disposal. Oh. I thought I saw somewhere that he had this idea that if they didn't have their organs, they wouldn't decompose and smell. Obviously, he was not a science student. Because I'm like, that's not how that works, man.
Going through like Egyptian lore or something.
No.
Oh, no.
Do your research. There was no Google, so he couldn't look it up.
That's true. He was like, the library is too far.
Right? He buried some of the limbs in the garden and in the shed. And then he stuffed torsos into suitcases until he could burn them in a bonfire in the garden. Again, adding a tire to disguise the smell.
Jesus.
At one of his bonfires, neighborhood kids came and watched the fire.
Oh, pretty.
Yay, right? God, I hope they didn't make s'mores.
My marshmallow tastes funny.
Gross. Once the fire had burned away the flesh, he would use a rake to search and make sure there weren't any identifiable bones. And if there were, he would use the rake to crush them.
Oh, wow.
Oh, he had this. Yeah, he had a whole thing. Now that he had space for more bodies.
I made space. Gotta start over.
Nilsen kept on killing. He's like, we got some space now.
Oh, God.
On September 17th, 1981, Dennis found 23-year-old. Oh, this one really bothers me. They all bother me, but this one. 23-year-old Malcolm Barlow slumped against a wall right by the door of his home. Malcolm was epileptic and was having issues with his medication.
Oh, no.
So Dennis helped him inside and called an ambulance for him.
What?
Yes.
How?
So Malcolm went to the hospital, and when he was released the next day, he went back to Dennis's flat to thank him.
Oh, my God.
Dennis invited him in, where they shared a meal and had drinks before Dennis strangled Malcolm in his sleep.
Oh, shit. Why even bother calling him help if you're just going to kill him? Ugh.
He's already, like, incapacitated. Like, what?
He must enjoy the act of the killing, and it was would have been too easy. Yeah. That's disturbing.
So he then stored his body under the kitchen sink until the next day.
Oh, he found another spot.
Mm-hmm. He's got all kinds of little cubbies and stuff.
Oh, God.
Malcolm Barlow was the last of the estimated 12 men killed at 195 Melrose Avenue.
Is this place haunted by any chance?
I would imagine.
Right? I'm hoping they burned it. Okay. Oh, yeah.
In 1981, the landlord wanted to renovate his flat.
Oh.
Maybe because everyone was, like, pissed because it smells. And he's like, you know what? Really maybe bad. I should redo this. Mm-hmm. Maybe. Let's just do an overhaul, shall we? So Dennis moved to a top floor flat at 23 Cranley Gardens. You know what I thought was really weird? He kept dead bodies for, like, 2 or 3 years at that other place. And the landlord renovated it. At no time during then was he like, what the fuck is stinking up this place?
Yeah.
Or, like,
no doubt. Or was it kind of a shady area, and so they were used to kind of having a slumlord?
Even, you know, you'd think even a slumlord would be like, dude, I think dead bodies have been on the floor here. Like, I don't know. I just think it's really weird that all that happened in that apartment, all the things that he did there and left them there, and he moved out.
Yeah.
Nobody was on to him.
Still nothing.
That was 81. He doesn't get caught till 83.
Oh, my God.
So.
Yeah, there's something weird there. Like, we'll just pour bleach on it. It's good.
Oh, my God. Yeah. He was like, this guy was a slob. We have definitely got to bleach this. Okay. I can't imagine the next people that moved in there. Oh. Just like, you know, like when they're like, do they have a cat? What is that?
Do they have a cat?
We have to replace the carpets. Oh, God. This is nasty. Yes,
this is bad. Something's wrong here.
Right. So, okay.
Burning sage and shit.
So he moves to this top floor flat at 23 Cranley Gardens.
Okay.
There he killed 3 more men.
God damn.
John Howlett, Graham Allen, and Stephen Sinclair. However, because he was on the top floor now instead of in a garden apartment, he didn't have floorboards.
Oh.
Or a garden for disposing of bodies. So he had to come up with a new method.
The roof didn't work for anything, huh?
Nope, guess not. One night, he was taking a dump. No, I'm just kidding. I just made that part up. And he got an idea.
Oh, God.
John Howlett was the first man strangled and dismembered.
Hmm.
Dennis took parts of his body and just kind of stashed them around his apartment. And then began flushing small bits of his remains down the toilet.
That seems like assuming, so much work.
Right? I mean... Can you imagine? I guess.
No.
It'd take a long time to.
Mm-hmm. I mean, a goldfish sometimes doesn't fit.
Oh, God. Doesn't go down, right? And you're like, I gotta flush it again.
Oh, I feel bad.
Mm-hmm. So he assumed that the flesh would either deteriorate or travel far enough into the sewers that it wouldn't be found or traced back to his apartment.
Oh, my God.
However, the building's plumbing was very old.
Oh, yeah.
And eventually it became so backed up that the other residents called in a plumber. Because they're just trying to take a shit. And
I just want to...
Oh, or flush a goldfish. And they're like, what the hell? Like, this toilet sucks. Back up.
Mm-hmm.
While police processed his flat, this top floor flat.
Okay, yeah.
They were able to collect several fingerprints. They were able to identify his last victim as 20-year-old Stephen Neil Sinclair. In the UK, and I know this because I watched, was it called Criminal? What was it called? Oh, it's such a good show on Netflix, where it all takes place in the interview room. It's a really good show. I have to find it. Anyway.
Okay.
They have 48 hours to charge somebody.
Oh, okay.
So they tried to get information. They tried to break him, whatever. So they had arrested him on suspicion of murder because there was a torso in his
apartment. Yeah, I'd say.
Right. Police have 48 hours to charge someone or they must be released. So they found fingerprints and they found...
Body parts?
Body parts, right? And they were able to... I don't know. I'm confused now that I'm reading it. But anyways, they were able to identify this Stephen Sinclair.
Maybe they got knuckle prints. I found your knuckles.
On February 12th, 1983, Dennis Nilsen was charged with the murder of Stephen Sinclair, which they estimated took place around 12 days earlier. So he had been in pieces in his apartment for 12 days.
Jesus Christ.
Police also found the fingerprints of Kenneth Ockington.
Okay. This is the Canadian
dude. Canadian tourist. Okay. Yeah. That he actually killed 3 years earlier. But they found a London street map that was his that he kept. So
treasures. Yeah.
Yeah, he kept his little treasures. Little and then they're like, interesting.
Oh, God.
Investigators began processing Nilsen's previous home at 195 Melrose Avenue because he said, the rest of them were over there, right? And they began the massive undertaking of digging up the frozen back garden.
Oh, God.
Look. Dennis even drew them a map showing them where they where he burned the bodies and where the other parts were buried. I even have a picture of the he is. He just was like,
it's like, I am so clever. Look at all these things I've been doing.
It was all just very matter of fact. And this is what I did. It was like he was talking about writing a book or something. Like, it was just
gross. Oh,
so it was freezing outside, the ground was frozen, but investigators tirelessly combed through the garden and recovered thousands of bone fragments.
Oh my god,
this is also frustrating, infuriating really. While looking into Nilsen's past, police were disturbed to find that he had once trained as a police officer. They were like, oh shit. And they discovered 5 separate complaints filed over the years from men claiming Dennis Nilsen had violently attacked them.
Oh my God.
Five. No one had flagged him at all.
Oh God.
Nilsen was questioned on 3 occasions because of these complaints, but no action was ever taken.
Oh my God. He's like, it's just this bondage fun we've been having.
Exactly. It's believed that because of the homophobia that was happening with the police and also just in the country at the time.
Right.
They're just
like, kind of like what they do to prostitutes.
Right. Exactly. They're not worth investigating.
Oh my God.
There was a whole big thing about how they made it sound a lot like London at that time was like Hollywood and Los Angeles, where everyone would flock there for jobs and to be somebody and to get out of their little podunk town and go out there. And then there were all these homeless who, they couldn't find it. There were all these jobless and homeless and stuff like that. And they believe that he got away with a lot of it because they wrote off all of his victims as, they were gay, homeless men.
They were expendable.
But they weren't all. Exactly. But they weren't all. I mean, they were all gay, but they weren't all homeless or transients
It shouldn't matter anyway, but.
Exactly. Ugh, right. And it's really pathetic how they just want to
absolutely brush it on the
floor. Lump them all together.
Exactly. To worry about.
So they started looking into the men who had filed complaints against him, right?
Okay.
And one of these men who had gone to police was 21-year-old Carl Stotter. Carl had, this poor guy. Carl had been disowned by his father when he came out as gay.
Right.
By April of 1982, he met Dennis in a pub and went home with him. And they went back to his flat in Cranley Gardens. So this is the new one.
A new place. Okay.
Right. Back at the flat, they continued drinking and Carl started to feel ill. So they went to bed. He suspects he may have spiked his drink or something. The rest of Carl's memory of that night is sketchy, but he did give interviews. He remembered hearing Dennis say, "Keep still."
Oh.
But then he passed out. So he doesn't remember what was happening. He just remember hearing him say that. And then passing out.
Oh, my God.
Then he woke to find himself in the bathtub. In an interview, this is a quote from him. "The thought that went through my mind was, you are drowning. You are being murdered by this man. This is what it feels like. And you're going to die."
Oh, my God. That's horrifying. Jesus Christ.
But for some reason, Nilsen stopped and began reviving him.
Oh, Jesus.
Don't know why. He actually helped Carl, who was confused, disoriented. Right. He helped him to a subway station.
What? I am so confused by this guy. Weird.
Carl went to the hospital and then reported what happened to the police. Unfortunately, Carl could only remember that the man's name was Dez and that he lived in Munswell Hill, and they didn't have a lot to go on. And police wrote it off as a lover's tiff.
Yeah.
Because that's what people do. Try to drown each other in the bathtub.
That's helpful. Thanks.
Yeah. I don't know what it is that they think is so different between homosexual relationships and heterosexual relationships, but in any situation, that's not a lover's tiff.
Not okay. No matter what, there's something wrong. That's assault.
Had he been investigated and caught after this attack, he would not have been able to go on to kill his last two victims. It would have saved at least two lives, but that unfortunately didn't happen. But Carl's testimony was vital in the murder trial. He did testify against
him. He did. Wow, that's pretty freaking brave, especially at that time.
Right? Because it's still...
It's
not
taboo.
It's still very taboo, right? You know, he's already lost his dad and part of his family about it. So.
Right.
In the fall of 1983, Dennis Andrew Nilsen was tried for 6 murders and 2 attempted murders, because he said he had murdered 15 or 16, but they had to go on what they had, right?
Yeah, that's what they could prove.
Right. So he pled not guilty on the grounds of diminished responsibility.
What?
Yeah. What? He was like, oh, well, I'm crazy. Jury didn't buy it. They're like, oh, no. You know it's wrong. You just don't care.
Yeah. Just don't give a shit. That's psychopath. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So he was found guilty. He was sentenced to life. And later it was added that there would be no parole. So he was sentenced to life with a minimum of something. And then they're like, nope, not even that.
Yeah. Good.
He confessed to killing 15 men. But as of 2021, police have still only been able to identify 8.
Oof.
So they have bodies for some or proof of some, but they can't identify. The 8 victims that they did identify are Stephen Holmes, Kenneth Octanton, Martin Duffy, William Sutherland, Malcolm Barlow, John Howlett, Graham Allen, and Stephen Sinclair.
Wow.
So those are the ones that they know. They all had families and loved ones.
Of course.
And, you know, they weren't just... throwaway people.
No.
28-year-old Graham Allen was from Glasgow, and he had a son or a child. He had a child.
Yeah.
He had a child. He was identified using a jawbone the police recovered that matched his dental records.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately, his identification came just days before Nilsen's murder trial, and so his murder was not added to the indictment. They already had 6.
Right.
I don't know that 7 was going to...
No, but for the family, it might have felt a little more justified.
Nilsen told author Brian Masters that he had cut the head off of Graham Allen's body, put it in a pot and set it to simmer, and then went to bed. In the morning, he checked on the simmering pot, then took his dog for a walk.
Like it's just a normal day.
And when he got back, he checked on it again and then ate a piece of toast. I mean, I also saw somewhere, but I don't know if it's true, that he considered feeding his dog some of it. But don't know if that actually happened.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this is a quote from Nilsen. A corpse is a thing. It can't feel. It can't suffer. If you're more upset by what I did to a corpse than what I did to a living person, then your morals are upside down.
Wow. He's one to talk about morals. We're going to not take your advice on that.
Wow. Thanks. Yeah.
Thanks for that.
Yeah, No, I'm upset by everything you did.
Yeah. Everything is equally shitty. So whatever it is, it's not good.
When Jeffrey Dahmer was caught in 1991, he gained so much notoriety that Dennis Nilsen began being referred to as the British Jeffrey Dahmer, despite the fact that he had been caught 8 years prior.
Yeah, so
because I wondered that too when I kept hearing that, and I was like, "But he came long
way before." Yeah, maybe he was like sad. I was the first.
Oh, believe me, he narcissistic bastard really was. There were many comparisons made between the two, as they both targeted young gay men. They both used strangulation as their method of killing. They both performed sex acts with the bodies. They dissected them. They kept body parts. As far as cannibalism, Dennis was quoted saying he was strictly a bacon and eggs man.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know why disturbing. But
I didn't even use some of the worst quotes. These are just some of the, like...
I think it's so disturbing because he is likening them to another type of flesh or, you know, to food in a way. Like, it's no big deal.
Right.
Ooh.
While in prison in the early 1990s, Dennis Nilsen corresponded with author Peter Paul Hartnett and asked him to edit his autobiography, which, by the way, he refused to do.
Thank God.
Nilsen did begin sending Peter 3 to 5 letters a week.
He's got nothing to do. He's like,
For years, he kept getting this mail.
That'd be horrifying.
With pages and pages of just horrific information. Mm-hmm.
Don't need it. Please stop.
Nilsen wrote that he had a regret about the murders. But
that he got caught?
Not even that. It's not what you would think at all. This is a quote from an interview from Peter Paul Hartnett. The regret was that he hadn't kept body parts in glasses of formaldehyde, genitals, or a pretty hand. If Nilsen had had the money, one of his fantasies was to have a van in which he could pick up hitchhikers, get them in the back of the van, gas them, and bring them home.
Whoa. He would have done it, too.
I guess it's a good thing he didn't have a better paying job.
Oh, my God. Was he saving up? Because he certainly wasn't buying anything nice for himself.
I don't know what he would... Apparently he was spending a lot of money on alcohol.
That's what I was just going
to say. And air fresheners and insecticides.
That's true.
Shit's expensive.
Knives.
Knives. Well, no, he stole the knives.
That's true. He did. He took the knives.
Criminologist Professor David Wilson has studied and met with several serial killers.
He had
read all about Dennis Nilsen and had high expectations when he was about to meet him. This is one of the quotes I like. But in an interview, he said when he finally met Dennis, he was, quote, completely underwhelmed.
He's a pathetic piece of shit.
Exactly.
Oh, my God.
In his experience, most serial killers are but Dennis spoke endlessly about his murders. He just went on and on. He wanted to control his story and control his legacy. He was a complete narcissist.
Legacy.
So, in that documentary, this is one I did watch. It's called The Real Dez, and it's on Sundance. In this documentary, David Wilson says, this is someone who was a complete and utter failure in his life. And the only way he could gain some sense of who he wanted to be was through killing and after he murdered. And that is the ultimate form of being a loser.
I love it. That is, you're a fart-sniffing loser.
Exactly.
The worst. Yeah,
exactly. Oh, although he denied it, there was evidence that Dennis did engage in necrophilia. And there's a suggestion that he engaged in cannibalism. They have things that suggest those things. When he was controlling his story, he said, no.
Of course, he doesn't want people to think shameful things of him. Like,
This, Carl Stotter, the victim that Nilsen ultimately revived and let go. The one who testified against him. He died in 2013. He had overwhelming survivor's guilt and became an alcoholic. I mean, he'd already survived and had an awful life and had so much stacked against him.
How sad.
He died alone at the age of 52.
Oh.
He spent 31 years of his life haunted by what happened.
Oh, it's that motherfucker.
In
some ways, you wonder if it would be better to die because I get it. Right. Oh, God. The pain. Right.
In May of 2018, Dennis Nilsen collapsed in his prison cell from a burst blood vessel in his abdomen.
Ooh.
He had only served 34 years of his prison sentence at this point.
Wow.
He'd only been in prison for 34 years. But his final hours were spent in excruciating
pain. I was going to say, that's like one of the most painful things you can experience.
He was 72 when he died.
Glad he paid a little bit of a price.
Exactly. Not nearly enough, but yeah.
Oh, my God. Did they say what he did with the sludge he cleaned out of the sewer system?
Oh, God. No, they didn't. Oh my God. I don't know what he did with it.
Wondering.
He put it in the next door sewer. Yeah. And then they were like, the shit, why is ours all clogged? And then
Kentucky Fried Chicken. Oh, that's very disturbing.
I know. So that's why people at Cranley Gardens couldn't take a shit.
This is why they weren't having one Dookie.
What just baffles me is that he killed potentially 12 people in an apartment building where people noticed that it smelled.
Yeah.
And then the landlord went in and he fixed it up and nothing.
How
right.
Is it
and
not
then
caught? I know.
People are going to the police. He gets caught because he clogged the fucking toilet.
It's true.
Right. I feel like he should be on World's Dumbest Criminals. You know that?
Oh, my God. For real. Yeah.
Right.
Oh, my God.
So, yeah. So that's how he got caught because he was flushing shit down the toilet. Right.
I mean, you can't even flush a tampon. Dude, how are you going to flush that?
Oh, I'm sure there for months they were sitting there going, well, it must be feminine products. That must be the problem. It must just be the feminine.
Flushing their feminine products.
That's what he should have said instead of the Kentucky Fried Chicken. He was like, you know.
Those are my feminine products.
Not supposed to flush those. Nope. See what happens.
See, ladies. Right? Blame it on the women, and it's the guys with flesh in the flesh.
Flush in the flesh. Jesus. That's a tough one.
It is a tough one.
Oh, God. All right. Would you like to hear my sources?
Oh, I'm afraid to, but yeah, I better.
Well, bring it. All that's interesting.com. Although all that's interesting. Murderpedia, of course. Mm-hmm. And Wikipedia.
Of course.
Of course. The Sundance documentary, The Real Dez, which is narrated. It's narrated by David Tennant. So you still got that voice.
Oh, good.
So. Okay. Anyway, so it was that one. And then there's the Netflix documentary, Memories of a Murderer, the Nilsen tapes. But I don't know. I had a really hard time listening to him go on and on.
Ew.
On.
Yeah, that
I mean,
sound
he
good.
Just was so like, what's the big deal? It's a body. Like, it just.
Wow.
Oh, God. It was just nauseating.
It is and very nauseating.
He helped people get jobs. I mean, he was in the army.
Yeah.
They said that he was like helped. He was like an activist in some ways or something like that. Like if people were protesting, he would join a protest. Like it was just so weird.
It's like he can compartmentalize.
Yes, exactly.
His killer instincts into something different. Ugh, creepy.
Right.
Makes you wonder how many are out there right now.
Mm-hmm. No, I hadn't thought of that. Thanks for that idea. That's great.
It's funny because I was thinking of looking up what they think is you know, our active serial killers right now. But I was like, oh, I don't know if I want to know.
I don't want to know. Anyway, because it's quieter at night, that's when I was doing most of my writing. But, you know, then I would go to bed. It was not good.
Yeah, we're going to have bad dreams for a little while after this.
Yeah, I'm going to need to. But I still kind of want to watch the, because I just want to see.
I know.
I want to see David Tennant in the docudrama. Yeah. I know. You know, so I don't know. I might need to pace myself.
That's a good idea. Like, give it a couple weeks. Try it again later.
Yeah. Oh, that was our lovely
story. Thank you for that one.
If you made it through, thank you, everybody.
Yeah. Please don't flush your feminine products.
Or anything else down the toilet.
Anything else.
Yeah. Sewer systems are not as strong as you think they are.
They're pretty damn weak.
You do not want Roto-Rooter coming out and
snaking that
checking
shit.
Out what's down there. Wow.
Oh, God, don't do it. Thank you.
Anyway, yeah, you're welcome. You're like,
thank you.
Could
I'll
have
never
gone the rest of my life without knowing any of that information.
Oh, God. That's a
rough
one.
He was just as horrific as Jeffrey Dahmer, and yet he wasn't nearly as
well known. No.
So I guess he didn't control his story well enough, did he?
Well, thanks for listening, everybody.
Yes, thank you.
Have a wonderful next week.
We will see you next week with something much lighter.
Maybe. Yes. I'll search for something a little lighter.
You know, just some.
We'll go on a diet. A little
just
diet.
Just a plain old, domestic something or other.
A little less dookie.
You know, something a little less dookie. God. So, anyways, thank you for listening and stay odd.
But not like
that
guy. No,
not
that
odd.
That's beyond odd.
I don't know what that is.
I don't know either. We don't want to know.
Bye.
Hey, Oddies, thanks for listening to another episode of ODFM. If you're a longtime listener, hey, we cannot thank you enough for your continued support. And if you're a new listener, thanks for giving us a try. If you like us, please drop us a like, subscribe, or rate us so we can share our stories with more people around the world. And if you'd like more information, like links to our podcast and socials, along with our Patreon fan page, those links are all on Linktree under ODFM Podcast. That's linktr.ee/ODFM Podcast. Side note, you guys, we're obsessed with fan art, and we love making things with it, like stickers for our fans. So if you'd like us to use your designs, send it to us at odfmpodcast@gmail.com. And if we use your design, we'll be sure to send you a sticker.
Thanks for listening to another episode of ODFM, hosted by Kelly DeVries and Jenna Swanson. Production and editing by Kelly DeVries. Theme music by Eric Swanson. ODFM is a satirical true crime podcast for entertainment purposes only. The stories you hear are serious and true. The comments and opinions are not. We apologize if any of our content is harmful or disrespectful.
Sam Fender returns with his brilliant new album, 17 Going Under. Includes the singles 17 Going Under, Get You Down, and Spit of You. Sam Fender, 17 Going Under, out now.